that.
I'm sorry.
Welcome back, everybody, to One True Theory. To follow up on the RWBY hype train that I started up in the last One True Theory, I decided that I was going to take it back real smooth now, y'all, and take one hop this time into talking about everyone's favorite character, Pyrrha Nikos. Our all-time favorite metal-manipulating sorry girl out of all of the characters in the show seems to be one of the very few that is not negatively talked about on a regular basis. Or very much. Which makes her the perfect contrast for Jean, once again, since he's the most dumped on character. But I digress. Whether it is out of respect because of Pyrrha's untimely demise at the hands of Cinder in Season 3, or because she is just a precious cinnamon roll, this character is well-loved and well-respected. Which is why it still stings so many people to this day, including myself, that she's gone and she's never coming back. Or so we all thought in the heat of the moment, and in the pits of our own despair. I have recently rewatched the series, and a lot of things stood out to me a lot more than they did the first time through. For the better. Mostly because that's where this theory comes in. What if Pyrrha isn't fully dead? Now, I know in the general sense this concept isn't fully original, but the angle I have seen this played out seems to focus more entirely on a little bit of Pyrrha being inside of Cinder. But considering Cinder has acted no differently since the fall of Beacon, except for having a huge hate boner out for RWBY, and more importantly had zero hesitation fighting Jon, and couldn't even remember who he was in Volume 5 at the start, I think it is safe to say that the series' most popular redhead isn't inside of Cinder somewhere. So where is Pyrrha then? Well, my party people, I think it is safe to say that Pyrrha has been with Jon and company the entire time. Not physically there, but in a very literal sense has been there. In spirit. Allow me to explain. In the final episodes of Season 3, Pyrrha is in the heat of the Fall of Beacon and makes the decision to become the new Fall Maiden. The machine that is used is designed to transpose the previous Maiden's aura into Pyrrha. Aura, being this universe's equivalent of a soul, which works in many different ways, including acting as a protective barrier for the body and manifesting into abilities known as semblances. This machine basically takes one person's soul and infuses it into another. With that, you get that person's power and abilities, but also will likely come out as a different person on the other side of this process. Ozpin gets this process started for Pyrrha, and we see the machine's tubing start to glow with a distinct orange aura. This is, of course, the aura of the Fall Maiden. This process gets cut decisively short by Cinder, who, after taking a page out of Ramsay Bolton's school of shooting a bow and arrow, kills the Fall Maiden and absorbs the rest of her power. Pyrrha, after making sure Jean is safe, goes off to fight Cinder alone, and despite her best efforts, is defeated by Cinder and is seemingly turned into ash a la something out of Marvel's Infinity War. I don't think she was turned into ash, though. Instead, I think Cinder broke Pyrrha down into her most base form. Her aura. Cinder destroyed Pyrrha's physical body, and the orange bits we see flying off are akin to the same distinct orange color we saw when we were trying to remove Amber's aura and put it into Pyrrha. A detail which seems superfluous but is actually very important to note because this means that Cinder, with the full use of the powers of the Fall Maiden, broke Pyrrha down to every living creature's most base form, her soul/aura. And although this might sound like it's reaching, Consider this. In the World of Remnant episode revolving around the Four Maidens, after the wizard grants the Four Maidens each around a fourth of his energy, they all start using their energy to do amazing things.
And the unimaginable magic of the wizard, the
Four Maidens, leaves around them with wind,
spring,
and most amazingly of all, creating plant life out of nothing. The Spring Maiden, in the short, created a living thing from seemingly nothing, and if RWBY is to be believed about anything, it's that all living things have an aura. So if the Spring Maiden, and by association all the maidens, can seemingly manipulate aura and create living things, even on such a small scale, then doesn't that mean they can take aura already present and break it down? So with this, it makes sense Cinder could break things down into aura, which for non-living things is easy, but much harder when it comes to living creatures, as a person's aura, when it's still active, most likely repels this effect. Pyrrha, being at the end of her rope though, allowed Cinder to easily aurify her. And we know Cinder aurified Pyrrha, because when she does it, Pyrrha glows of the same orange color we saw being transferred between a previous Fall Maiden and her in the machine. A side effect of Cinder's maiden-fueled aura manipulating what's left of Pyrrha's aura/soul. So Pyrrha has been turned into aura, and we quickly see orange flakes disappear, which I believe is the simple fact that aura cannot exist corporeally without, well, a body. So with this means we can no longer physically see her. But we know she is still around. Her soul/aura is following around the group, primarily John, the whole way through Anoa. How we know this comes from Volume 4, Episode 2. A couple of times through the episode, RWBY is awoken from her sleep because she swears she can hear Pyrrha. The first of these incidents, she hears Pyrrha's final words with Cinder. This was a conversation she was not present for and had no way of hearing. In the second dream, she is calling out for Jean in a way that doesn't feel like she's remembering something from the past, but rather that she is hearing it in the here and now. This happens the first time closer to around dawn, and once again in the middle of the night later on. At the end of the episode, we are led to believe that RWBY is only having these dreams because of a combination of overhearing Jean training to a recording Pyrrha made for him, and her own guilt and trauma of the situation. The RWBY has even cited PTSD and generalized stress as the culprit, and although both of those things can make you hallucinate, especially when intense enough, the likelihood that RWBY would have been hallucinating the exact same conversation Pyrrha and Cinder had is small. And to follow that up, the likelihood of her having a second incident of Pyrrha sounding like she's very actively trying to call out to Jean, while Jean just so happens to be depressed, angry training to a video Pyrrha sent him back during the Beacon days, is practically impossible. All of this doesn't add up. As I've mentioned before, the first time RWBY has this dream, she wakes up and it is nearly morning. RWBY looks around and finds everyone asleep, including Jean. There's no way she could have heard the recording to stimulate the dreams that night, and more to the point, there's no way she is remembering someone's final words that she not only didn't hear, but couldn't have heard ever. All of this, unless Pyrrha's spirit truly is following the group around like I had suggested, and if Pyrrha's spirit really is following them around, then what does that mean for RWBY going forward? I believe Pyrrha Nikos is going to fuse her aura with Jean and become a part of Jean. I want Pyrrha back in her own body more than anything else, but I don't readily see that as a possibility. Her body is gone, and outside of an Atlesian android duplicate body, RWBY has given us very few ways for her to have her own body. I think Jean and Pyrrha's auras fusing is the best thing for these two moving forward, because it will A, allow Pyrrha to keep her promise and always be there for Jean, B, give Jean back the one person who has always believed in him, C, give Jean more of an interactive person to help him train, someone who really understands the best way to teach him, and D, in the worst case scenario, Pyrrha could probably use Jean's body to seriously kick some butt, and I'm pretty sure we'd all be excited to see Pyrrha kick some butt again. And lastly, Pyrrha will be reaching her destiny, her final goal that she's worked towards her whole life, by helping people and helping save the world, and Jean will be reaching his by finally being able to step up more as a warrior and a hero. And they'll have each other to thank for it. But those are just my thoughts. So until next time, everybody, remember, every video is a party, and you're all invited to the next one. Thank you, and have a good night.